Me too.
Beautiful faces. You know, they're not perfect.
I don't know, pretty close.
Thank you.
Thank you.
This is a great way to start the interview. No, I was fishing. I wanted to see where he went with it.
You guys were in elementary school together, or?
Yes. We were at elementary school together.
We were born
together.
At the same hospital.
Yeah.
And you know? Have been friends ever since.
We were right next to each other, and I remember our little hands reached up over the lip of each little crib and just started holding hands from a very early, well, I guess we were infants. So.
Yeah. So. No. Really? I'm much younger than
so
you.
So you digress.
No, I'm
like,
much
no,
younger.
No,
like, I'm much
like
younger.
Someone at home was like, oh, what a beautiful story.
I'm much younger than
you. Did it also say yes and? As the,
yeah, exactly.
The
yeah.
principal.
Not much younger than me. Close.
No.
No, we met at the, our first interaction with each other was at the Groundlings Theater.
In a class or in a
yeah.
group?
No,
or?
In the Sunday.
No,
well,
yeah.
We met up in the Sunday Company, which is like the last level of the school before, it's like the farm team for the Groundlings, and then your hope is to be voted into the main company, which subsequently we were. But we met there and spent a year in the Sunday Company, and then we were both in the company for 11 plus years.
So were you trying out other people during that time for your voting life activity,
uh-huh.
or were you like immediately connecting?
No, we auditioned other people to play our partners.
Yeah.
some success, but...
No, surprisingly, a lot of people turned me down. You know, I was auditioning them, but they said, you know what, I don't want to be part of your team. So I gave him $50 and we were off.
And we've been best friends ever since.
Well, I mean, did you go out and like have dinner one night and just say, okay, let's write the script or?
No, I think, you know, in the Groundlings, you write, you know, when you're putting up a show, you, in the main company, you know, there are 30 members in the company and maybe half of that or less will do a particular show. And so you write for about 6 weeks and you write your own material and then you write with other people that are going to do that show. And so after a while you sort of end up leaning towards the same, you know, some of the same people that you've had good experiences with or that you like their sense of humor. And so that was sort of, you know, the case with Jim and I. You know, we just sort of, you know, became good friends first and then, you know, had a good time writing together and had the same, you know, kind of, I don't know, point of view on some things and...
on most of our things.
Most.
And then, we just enjoyed it. And then I think, you know, the writing was really born out of frustration of being sort of pigeonholed as an actor and not being able to do something maybe with a little more meat on it or have a little more responsibility, you know? And so we really started writing outside, you know, other things besides sketches as a way to further our acting careers. And then it just kind of took off from there.
So as a writing team, it's not conflict that drives us, or that you're so different than each other, it's kind of a simpatico?
It's a little bit of both.
I think we're more driven that we are, you know, slightly opposites,
yes.
My guess. But I think that works for our advantage, you know. I think while we have sort of similarities in the type of stories we're drawn to and our type of humor, we're obviously completely individuals, and I think that we each bring different things to a partnership. So I would say it is a mixture of both. But at its core, I think we both came through a training of character-based comedy and obviously subsequently drama, because comedy is pain. And so they mesh together. And so I think that training is something that we take to heart with whatever we're writing.
So does the success of this and the hopeful ongoing success of this as it opens keep you together more, or is it, do you guys like having other families that you go off to and act and do whatever and have a limited amount of contact?
I don't. I would like to be with Jim all
and
the
I
time.
And I need as much time off as I can get. I need a lot of me time. I think we have a nice balance. I think, you know, Nat does have a family, but I think we always know when it's time to, like, you know, take a break if we're writing together, because at the end of the day we were friends before any of these things happened, so we're never gonna let those things be jeopardized. But we also have had separate careers, you know, certainly on acting. Mm-hmm. You know, neither of us have been on a series together. We've done similar shows, you know, like mm-hmm. Reno 911 at different times. But we've always had like sort of series regular different paths. And mm-hmm. and so I think we always are aware when someone wants to do something else or someone's involved with not shooting a movie or I'm doing something else. And it's like, but we always have this connection. So I think it's healthier to have a little bit of both.
Mm-hmm. Not in my mind, but.
Like I said, I need a break.
So was the idea of directing together just a natural outgrowth of having written together and figuring you could figure out how to make it work? Or did you think about it a lot?
Yeah.
No, I mean, pretty much. I think, you know, because this, you know, was like an 8-year journey in terms of when we first wrote it and mm-hmm. to actually completing it, you know, we watched a lot of other directors come on board and, you know, where the movie was almost going to happen and then it fell apart and then we went to another studio and a different director. And so I think through that process, you obviously, you know, you hear different people's visions of what they think it should be and who they would cast and where they would shoot it. And then, you know, ultimately we got to a point where it was sort of like, you could make this movie right now, but you have to use, you know, somebody off of this list or you're not going to make it, you know, with us. And Jim and I think both felt, you know, we wanted to protect the integrity of the movie and the vision, and so we just sort of said, well, then we'll hold off and let's wait and make it the way we want to make it in the right way. And so finally, when we got the script back in our hands and kind of had ownership of it, we just kind of started over and hit the reset button and said, let's try to do it ourselves and let's direct it and see what happens. Mm-hmm. And we'll sort of just learn by doing, and that's kind of what we did. And it was so gratifying to be able to, you know, complete the journey and to see the vision from start to finish. You know,
this script, the way back, sort of got around town when we first wrote it, and fell onto the desk of literally fell onto the desk of Alexander Payne and his producing partners, Jim Taylor and Jim Burke, and they had optioned The Descendants, the book, and so we went in among, I'm sure, other writers to sort of meet with them and talk about our ideas and how we would approach it, and luckily got the job, and so then weirdly then The Descendants and, you know, certainly the success of that and coming off the Academy Awards, we were able to, like, I think really at least get the momentum to open this back up the mm-hmm. way back and to remind people of this script. So mm-hmm. in a way they sort of...
So this deal came off of The Descendants in that regard, in terms of the timing, yes?
It did, well, yes. I mean, we...
There were many ups and downs while we were doing The Descendants. We thought we were going to make it, we aren't going to make it. Not with us directing at the time. Right. We went through several directors. But I think then, like Nat said, we'd had a moment where they were like, you can make it with this list, or we need to walk away for a while, mm-hmm. you know, while it's in turnaround. So we walked away, I would say, for another 2 years, mm-hmm. you know, maybe three. And then we sort of, as The Descendants was going, pre the awards, we sort of, with our producing, producer Kevin Walsh, we sort of started a more grassroots approach, and so then I think that all sort of helped us mm-hmm. sort of
and a pretty
together.
Quick turnaround once you were there, huh?
Once,
yeah. But
slowly we had the cast come together.
It was, you know, we did it independently, so obviously, you know, you need the cast to get financing, you need financing to get the cast, and mm-hmm. So we sort of piece by piece, you know, got a little bit more momentum and, you know, got a few actors to sort of join us, and then we got a little piece of the financing, and then, you know, Steve Carell was the last person to come on, and once he did, then really the movie got very fast and real, and we started shooting, you know, a few right. months later.
Well, you were shooting, I guess you were like a year and 4 or 5 months after Descendants went through the award season, you were in production.
I guess.
That summer.
Yep.
That's right. I think that's right. Yeah.
Pretty quick once it happens. Yeah. No, I think the window seems even shorter.
I know.
From this perspective.
I'm trying to remember. It's all
Blurred. It's weird, because we shot it just a year ago. We would be on our way, probably, to for pre-production. We have to leave. Yeah. If we were in a time machine, us talking to you, we gotta go.
I'm so confused.
But I wouldn't even know how good the movie was, so it was, you know.
That's right. This would be. Really this would make interview. No sense. This would be like Inception, but people would be like, oh, I don't get it.
Santa Monica Inception would not be a big
deal. Yeah, no. Think. We don't have a constant here.
Not really happening.
The Ferris wheel.
Ferris wheels are constant. As yeah. long as we know it's there, we're yeah. still attached to this world.
So whose childhood was this? Or was it your guys' childhood watching Meatballs? Or
guess.
Both.
Guess. Guess which one of us was a nerd.
I'm guessing not you.
Wow.
How dare you? Yeah, how good. Fucking
you
dare
were smart,
you?
But you were wrong.
You son of a bitch.
No, we, the movie wasn't really inspired more than just one thing. It was a few things sort of fueled it, but first was the beginning scene of the movie in the car when Steve Carell's character asked Liam James' character what he thinks he is on a scale from 1 to 10. That actually happened to me. That was sort of ripped from the headlines of my years of being 14. I say years as if there's more than one. I stayed 14 for about 10 years and then decided, you know, it's time to move on. But
that's how you keep your young, youthful good looks.
Thank you. See?
And you just jumped to 24.
Yeah, jumped to 24. Yeah, and then people were like, you age fast. I said, no. I was
14
I chose to be 14 for a long time. So that actually happened to me with my stepfather at the time when we would spend our summers driving up to Michigan. And that was a conversation we had because I wasn't taking advantage of my summer, apparently. Mm-hmm. So we sort of start with that. And I think Nat and I are always attracted to, same as when we did the TV show, something very dramatic happening to a character. And I think that's where you start to mine such rich, interesting, both comedy and drama. So we knew we wanted to sort of throw that out, maybe that the beginning and launch. And then we also both had a fondness for going to water parks on both on the East Coast, different areas. And just that deep
love,
just a deep like, you know, just totally spooning the crap out of a water park, you know, like you don't even like if it was that person would just have high regard for you because you'd never leave. You like you do your business and then you just
what is happening?
You said it, and then I went with it. So I'm just chatting.
So I guess Nat grew up being Sam. Was that the punchline?
I still am. I'm sort of Jim's Owen. Mm-hmm. I'm sort of helping him along.
But I have to say, as a mentor, I've learned nothing.
He's at one point there will be a rite of passage. We haven't gotten there mm-hmm. yet.
Well, I was 14, now I've been 24 for the last 15 years. So I'm getting ready to be what my age is now, which is none of y'all's business.
You're finally getting good at it.
Yeah.
29.
Yeah, 29.
So did you love the 80s movies, the early, those movies?
We did.
Was that part of this at all, or is there a point
the meatballs thing, certainly the idea of the inspiration?
Rockwell, yeah, was that Sam's character was modeled after Bill Murray, you know, and when we were thinking of who is, you know, our Bill Murray of now, and we immediately thought of Sam, really, and but certainly those movies, and you know, the movies of John Hughes, for example, you know, where we grew up watching those movies, and I think you know had a fondness for the ability to mesh, you know, sort of the drama with the comedy, you know, and to
he
not
was so
talk
good
down
at that.
The kids.
Yeah.
And
he was so good at balancing those things out and also not shying away from the problems they had, you know. And I think there's a nostalgia there that I think we tried to go for with The Way, Way Back to mm-hmm. sort of feel like a movie that's sort of a throwback, you know, in a way.
Mm-hmm. So did you direct with that in mind?
Yes. Yeah, very much so.
When
I mean, it was conversations. You know, we had a lot of lengthy conversations when we were in, you know, pre-production, and we talked to John Bailey, our cinematographer, a lot about that and different ways we could achieve that cinematically.
Did Bailey shoot any of those movies?
He shot a ton of them.
Lord, from Ordinary People Big Chill, Groundhog Day. If we could get this whole list.
No, he's a great DP, but it's like, I wonder whether he actually shot it during the 80s, any of the kids, you know.
Oh, yeah, those probably.
He might have one or two on his resume.
I'm sure.
He might.
Probably. But he certainly understood, I think, you know, what we were going for. And But we tried to infuse that nostalgia in a lot of things, certainly in
the music as well.
The music in set direction, you know, the set direction.
The costumes.
Yeah. Anne Roth was. We just lucked out to have her as our costume designer, and same.
I mean, she's okay.
I mean, she's okay. She's done a couple of things. Like,
yeah. You know, Georgia Sneaker. You her number too?
Yeah. But yeah, she. Yeah, same sort of thing. Like sort of blending the timelines. You know, keeping it sort of timeless. You have cars. You have. Modern cars, you've got obviously a station wagon, but they're all connected to where the characters are in their lives. Obviously Trent is connected to his past more and what his dad was for him and restoring this car and however he was raised, he's clearly approaching that way with talking to Duncan. You have music that feels like it would be the beach house because it's like the CDs that were left there. Then you get to the water park and we get a couple more current songs, but you still get Owen's influence, so you have a little throwback stuff.
In general, too, I think, you know, beach vacations have that, you know, innately in the sense of, you know, where you spend your year and maybe you change or things happen and then you go back and it's as if nothing has changed, you know, that your beach house is still the same, still get the same music and the disc changer, and, you know, the water park is still the same. It's, still, you know, from...
Yeah, there's comfort in that, I think, for people with destinations. They go, like, they close up the house and they expect the house just to be the way it was when they closed up for the winter, you know. And I think that's... They're always hoping to relive last summer, you know, if it was a good one, hopefully. It's sort of like Betty's, you know, sort of diatribe of what's been going on this year. It's like, here's all the things that have happened, but now let's move on and just have fun. In other words, this happened, and now on to the fun.
Yes. You know?
It's like, and I assume with Bailey, you shot on film.
No, we didn't. We wanted to.
He reminded us.
Yes, he talks about it a lot. He's really into the film.
He wanted to, yes.
He says on the next one.
On the next one. But yes, we unfortunately couldn't just because we were a smaller movie.
At some point, yes.
Difficult.
So was Betty the easiest character to write or the hardest character to write?
The most fun, you know, I would say that I think Betty and Owen were always fun to write because they both operate for sort of a almost a weird stream of consciousness, you know, their own sort of riff. I ordered some egg salad. Is my egg salad ready?
Or my shrimp cocktail? We chose items that we thought would be...
Oh, egg salad and shrimp cocktail would be just... Yeah. What a delicious appetizer and main course.
I think one time on a plane, somebody did that to me.
What?
Opened like a container of egg salad that they had brought home.
I'm sorry. They need to fix this.
Oh, no.
They need to fix this.
And then an hour and a half later, it's really bad.
Yes.
People being Tupperware of cooked food, I don't know. I'm not into it. It's the same as going to a movie theater and someone said, oh, I just brought all this to-go food. I'm not into it.
But Betty's in agony through all of this. She's also, I mean, as funny as she is, she's also... A lot of pain there, I think, more than Owen, certainly.
Yes, for sure. I think, you know, again, I think, you know, she's obviously suppressing and pushing down a lot of issues that she's not dealing with, obviously, with a new divorce, but also a husband coming out. And I think she is trying to convince herself that she's okay. And I think she sees in Pam someone who, even though Pam is, both of them are sort of stuck in this, not quite operating on their best cylinders moment as mothers and as individuals and trying to figure it out. But I think they respect each other because they identify that it's a scary time for both of them. And I think that that's, you know, sort of one of the big themes is that we, in a good ensemble, all these characters are feeding each other at the right moment, at the right time in their lives, you know, whether some of them's paths will cross again, we don't know, but for this blip, they serviced each other in a way that I think that's what summer can be about, you know, when you go to a camp or you go to a destination, you know, sort of location, you're with these people for once a year, and in that one time, they could just change everything going forward, so I think that's a fun thing to mine.
So do you guys have any fear? I mean, I'm probably a few years older than both of you, but not that much older. I mean, that feeling of this kind of movie, that sense of the beach, and all of that stuff that seems very kind of right in a lot of ways, and I think was a lot of the reaction at Sundance, that this bigger audience that Searchlight is going after will all get it? Or does that just seem so human that you hope it'll work out and don't even think about it, worry about it?
Yeah, I mean, I think all coming-of-age stories are relatable, you know? I mean, I think most people can harken back to a time or a summer or a year where they had that sort of rite of passage, you know, where they went through some sort of, you know, evolution as a person. And so I think, you know, hopefully when the audience, you know, other audiences watch this, they will connect to that, you know? I mean, that's sort of the hope, I think, you know, and that there is hope, in a sense, you know, that you sort of look back at that time of your life and think, oh, I wish I could have told myself when I was going through that it was going to be okay, you know, and you're sort of naturally rooting for that person because you sort of see yourself in them in a way, and you get to the other side and you're like, oh, it's okay, it's, you know, it all works out, you know, but you empathize with somebody who's going through it, I think, so.
I just think, I think it's gutsy. I mean, in a weird way, I think this is like, we have a generation of fairly cynical kids these days.
Yes.
And I think if they let themselves enjoy the movie, that they'll be really surprised and, you know.
Yeah.
I think it's something we haven't seen in a while.
Yeah.
We're kind of glorious in that way.
I hope so. I mean, I personally miss these movies, and I think it's sometimes, I think there is something, you know, we can tend to go a little more cynical or quirky with some, you know, whether it's independent or a bigger budget movie. But I think, you know, not that these movies don't exist by any means, but it to me, it's I like those movies who that balance that sort of comedy drama in such a way that makes it feel real, and I'd like to be able to connect to it, to the characters in a way, and I love flaws, and I think we both do. I love people acting in not the best moment of their life because we understand them and there's a sympathy there. So I like that. I like confusing the audience sometimes, like, you know, especially like Carell's character. Why is he such a dick? You know, and then when you really get down to it, we can discuss them and you start to understand these are all just human beings, and they have good amount of flaws.
So how did you guys end up working out the directing thing?
We're still trying to figure it out.
Yeah,
you know, we did.
I still want to call action, and I'm not allowed.
I mean, just the way he said action right there, would you ever want to prepare?
Action!
I mean, that would not just make me not be able to act, I would just quit it altogether.
Well, I had looked the part. I had the balloony pants, and I had the stick.
Balloony pants, clearly. Well, he is a director to the core. Where are my balloony pants?
My pantaloons!
My pantaloons. We gotta find out what those things are called. They're horse riding pants. But
Joffers, I think.
Joffers. Oh, there we go. See now.
In your face.
Not really.
Sort of.
Not really.
Not at all.
But both our faces, really. I don't want to say our style, because obviously this is our first time out of the gates. But here's how we've honed it. But I think, you know, we can
point to this vast
collection. When we first, our first film was back in, oh.
It's last year.
It's right now. Way back was our first film. No, we were friends way before we even started writing together and before this opportunity to direct. So I think we just operate the way we would as friends, but at the same time try to make sure we were checking our egos at the door, in other words, to listen to each other and try to, and usually we were, I'm not saying we had to try to come to a consensus. I think we were always on sort of the same page because we know the story so well for spending 8 years with it. And then when it came to the actual physical task of directing, I think we just tried to, our inner actors made sure that we sort of pulled from the things that we appreciated on the sets that we've been with or the directors we worked with. We try not to inundate our actors with too many notes, and certainly not from both of us. We would just sort of take turns, you know, communicating our thoughts.
So you just look across the camera when somebody screwed up and go, I got this one, or?
I think we know, you know, we would just sort of collect what we wanted to do, and then one of us would just, you got this, you know. Yeah. I think we just went off who most eloquently said it in the moment.
Yeah.
That seemed good. That was short and sweet. You go do it, you know. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, one of us would usually sit by the monitor, and one would stay closer to the camera.
But it changed. It wasn't just like one.
No,
we didn't.
Neither
we didn't
one of us had like, oh, I'm good at this and you're good at that.
Yeah. As much as, you know, I'd love to say I was super technical, you know, and I was more the camera guy.
Yeah, John Bailey always looked at me and says, he was always like, what lens should we use? And John and I would connect. And,
yeah.
And then we talk about filters and everything. And John would say, I'm glad you're here.
And I was always doing, like, acting exercises with the cast, you know, a lot of, like...
All of them, though, none of them appreciated, because it was just, like, really basic improv skills. Like, there's this thing where you lift a disc. So let's just lift this manhole together and remember teamwork. And they kept going, like, I get it. Or you do rubber baby buggy bumpers.
Space work. That was a lot of space work. And then they said, but we have actual props. And
I said, no.
Imagine if you didn't.
Show us the space where that cup is before you grab the actual cup.
And a lot of line readings for Corelli, I assume.
Oh, yes.
Yeah.
He loved our line readings.
Yeah.
Wow. you know, I think the best thing, our actors, what was great about all of them is I think for them, the best thing we could do is just chat about the character and about the intention of the scene, and then I think they took it from there, and then we could do a few takes without cutting, and then sort of tweak or what if need be. Mm-hmm. But for the most part, they all came so prepared because we're shooting a movie on a limited amount of time, so there wasn't the benefit of oh, we're going to rehearse most of the morning, then we're going to, you know, we were shooting 6 pages a day in order to make this. And we got rain and all these things that would set us back. So our cast was always variable, came to the table, but all just malleable to all those things. Mm-hmm. You know, they've been around long enough to know we got to go.
So was there a point in post where you knew you had something that was really working, or did it take till you got to that screening at Sundance? Or?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think you ever totally know. I think you know. I think we felt proud and comfortable with the story that we were trying to tell, and certainly it matched what our vision was right from the start. And so there was something that you could at least tactically point to as to say, okay, this is at least what we envisioned, you know. Whether people are going to respond, I don't know, but I think certainly the reception at Sundance, you know, was such a wonderful, it was so... it was such a nice release in a way, you know, because you just
because we didn't like, know at that point, 20 maybe people had seen the movie, maybe 20 to 30 people had seen it, and so this really was now what 15 or 1200?
Yeah, like 13, almost 1300.
Almost 1300 people eyes now on it, and we're sitting among them and just sort of hoping for the best.
Yeah,
and our cast hadn't seen it, so
very really, nervous or a little nervous.
Highly nervous.
We were so. Pale and
a paler for
for Jim, and looking uncomfortable while we were waiting to go introduce the movie at Sundance, that the programmers came up to us and said, would you guys like to do a shot of whiskey just to sort of relax a little bit? And we're like,
a lot of people on stage thought, oh, there's Nat and a ghost. So everyone thought it was haunted for a second.
So
after
it was so,
and then it became
it was so nice,
a nice pink.
Was there a moment in the movie where you kind of knew you got them? Me being one of them, I was sitting there. Why was at that screening?
You know, it's hard because you know, I don't know. I guess I realized the first scene played sort of what I thought, which is usually there's always sort of a shock when he says three. You know, it's sort of like takes people aback, but then. When Betty comes on, there's this, you know, it's like, this is what we're going for. We're going to throw you a punch. And then Betty's going to come in. And I think it was her. I think
just watching
that whole thing and just feeling them. Because instantly, you could feel them on board, certainly with her character. But I think scene by scene, you're always sitting there going, like, you know.
Yeah.
But I think at some point I started to relax. I just don't know exactly what it was. Mm-hmm. Maybe it was after that first Roddy scene, so I knew that they didn't hate us.
And then Searchlight just stuck a little check in your pocket while you were watching, or?
So weird.
Here you go, boys.
It's like a prostitute.
Oh, okay. I will
partake in you later. No, what was great, it was like after we finished, you know, we had obviously our sort of quick Q&A, which is very difficult because you're all just sort of standing up there and you're emotional and try to answer these questions. And then you're sort of swept off and we're in this hallway and everyone's congratulating you and still they're trying to push you out. So all this time, none of that stuff's really happening until we got, you know, into the parking lot, you know. And then, you know, your producers go into, you know, here's what's happening, you know, blah, 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 you know.
Yeah.
They're interested, these people are interested, all that kind of stuff. But I, honestly, that was the last thing on my mind at that moment. Mm. You know, my first thing was that I could comprehend was being as present as I could for this one moment, you know. Mm. And it was hard not to be, but I just needed that. Really, you know, the next part obviously is all the icing, but it's for that moment being on stage with them and getting to feel the reaction and getting to answer their questions and then getting to hear like a good friend like Maya, who we came to the Groundlings with each other and, you know, it was no brainer that we wanted to work with her or many others, but having her in the movie was such a wonderful experience. Both as a friend and as her as a performer, but in that moment, you know, she answered one of those questions, but, you know, speaking so kindly of us and the process, you know, just realize, oh, this is worth all of it, you know, these people who are now friends, you know, making a dream come true type thing, blah, 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 blah.
You didn't take the check.
Huh?
You gave the check back then.
No, and I said, no, thank you, sir, and then he freaked out.
Yeah. And then I taped it back together and said, yes, please.
That is kind of the holy grail of Sundance, is that Searchlight wants your movie. I mean, that's like,
yeah,
everybody's waiting around hoping.
Well, it's amazing
because
it felt, yes, it was always from the beginning like that, you know, this would be great, you know, if this worked out. But, you know, you don't know. And then there are other suitors. And, you know, luckily for us, there were lots of offers. And, you know, we were sort of told, like, hey, we're going to go, you know, our producers and investors, we're sort of going to go vet it out. And you guys just sort of be on standby. And at that point, I was just so thankful that it had gone well and that people didn't boo us and hate us and, you know, so then it was just like a party for a while, and then to get a call at like 2:30 in the morning, like, okay, we're ready for you guys to come in and start talking to these people. It was like, I'm sorry, what now? It's very loud in this bar. And then to go into meetings, it was so surreal.
You're sort of dazed.
And then like,
you know, early in the morning.
And then the deal gets done at like 5:30 in the morning, you know, so incredible.
And will you guys be nervous or ramped up the day before you have opening this time? It's a couple weeks away. Mm-hmm. Is that a nerve-wracking day, or are you kind of already?
I think so. I mean, we'll be on the road, sort of still doing some kind of promotion stuff, actually traveling with our hero car down the East Coast. So yeah. It'll be interesting because I don't know where that day is. But, you know, we actually don't get back to L.A. until after, you know, it's premiered, at least in, you know, L.A. and New York and some other markets. But I would imagine it's going to be very stressful.
I'm sure it will. Although, I will say, like, we've got so much, you know, good has come from this, you know, and I think certainly just at least the reaction at Sundance alone was, you know, like as Jim said, just worth the whole journey. Just because it was, you know, I feel so fortunate and blessed to have gotten here, you know? And obviously you want the movie to do well and, you know, you want the ability to do it again and, you know, but at least so much fortune has already sort of been bestowed upon us, I think, with this, so.
But you don't see a lot of teams rooting for their writer-directors quite as much. There seems to be this seems to have been a real love fest in a lot of ways.
Oh, that's good. Yeah, it was. I mean, it really was. It was, you know, that was something we talked about, you know, being first-time directors very early in the process. You know, we sort of said, you know, we want to make this movie and we want to find great talent and people to be a part of it, but we also want to surround ourselves with people that we not only respect and love as performers, but also like good people that will do this for the right reasons and the spirit of making a film like this, you know, because it is a small budget. It's not a financial like windfall for a lot of these people. And I think it's just a chance to do something creative, to work with, you know, fantastic people. And I think that, you know, we sort of carried that through as we were shooting and beyond. You know, it was really just about like the spirit of it and the camaraderie of it and the, you know, collaborative spirit.
Yep. See how it collaborated? Yep.